Good morning to all of you. It's indeed a great pleasure for me to be back in Uganda, in Kampala. Uganda being a country with which I have a bit of a special relationship. As the chair said, I was here for the first time in 1991, and I did some work with George Barillo, at the time a young district health officer in the Hoima district, and we worked together with UNICEF, but also with the School of Public Health of Makerere University, that was in the early 90s, still headed by Professor Gilbert Bukenya. So happy to be here, happy to meet again the many friends from Makerere, and I've taken the occasion this morning to put my Makerere tie to honor this. Speed program quite a track record when it comes to organize state-of-the-art international conferences. So again, this is the third conference within the time span of the program, and I'm very happy and honored to be here. My presentation will be centered largely on primary healthcare, and more specifically on the relationship, the linkage between primary healthcare and universal health coverage. To some extent, I'm going to come back to issues that Professor Joshua from ECSA has addressed yesterday, but I think these are important issues, and important issues deserve to be repeated. In some more detail, I would like to address rapidly the following dimensions, that the following elements that were quite central in the discussions in Almaty 41 years ago, but also in the Astana conference last year in 2018, and that are still very much relevant. So I want to say a few words on trying to define primary healthcare. Say a few words also on the meaning of health. I think it's difficult to talk about primary healthcare and healthcare without trying to grasp what we mean under health. Then there is, I think, the complex issue of how actually to implement primary healthcare. What should be the organizational formats? How should we go about to put it in practice, to operationalize it? I want, as I said, say a few words on the link between universal health coverage and primary healthcare. On multisectoral collaboration, of course, also not so an easy discussion, and with all due modesty, perhaps formulate a number of ideas, suggestions for the Ugandan health system. Last year, in 2018, at ITM, we organized an international colloquium and celebrated the 40th anniversary of the Alma-Ata Declaration. And my colleague and friend, Dr. Juliet Nabionga from WHO, was present there. The Alma-Ata Declaration, this landmark declaration, eventually led to the global strategy of health for all at the World Health Assembly in 1979. In 1978, I was myself a student in the fourth year of the medical school in Leuven, in Louvain. And I had never heard about primary healthcare, nor did I hear something about it in the rest of my medical studies. I heard for the first time about PHC and Alma-Ata in the classes of in Antwerp of the late Professor Harry van Balen, one of my mentors, when attending his course, and I must say a world opened. The Alma-Ata Declaration indeed was a radically a new perspective on what health is about, on healthcare, and on health system. And Van Balen, the late Professor Van Balen, who himself attended the meeting in Alma-Ata in 1978, was very clear in his teaching about PHC. He insisted very much that the Alma-Ata Declaration was not the brainchild of some bureaucrats in Geneva, but it was all about the crystallization of lessons on the dysfunction of health systems accumulated in the years and decades before. And that He referred to the fact that healthcare delivery systems were still largely hospital-based, with an excessive medicalization of health problems, with poorly developed community participation, with all too often patronizing health professionals, neglecting the psychosocial dimensions of health problems, the huge inequities, etc. This paragraph is taken from Article 6 of the Alma-Ata Declaration. I'm not going to read it out literally, but PHC is about access, is about rational care, is about participation, is about equity, is about the need for multisexual collaboration. And it is quite striking that this landmark agreement fit in mere 3 pages, comprising 10 articles. As Kabir Sheikh, currently director of the WHO Alliance for Health Systems and Policy Research, wrote at some point in time, the declaration's appeal consists of its dual character. On the one hand, it is part gospel of applied science. At the other, it is a political manifesto. PHC is about scientifically sound care, but at the same time about a right-based approach and about a call for a new global economic order to address political, economic, social determinants of health. And I believe that it is important, even crucial, to keep this perspective on the agenda and to share and discuss it with younger generations of health professionals worldwide, from the South, but also from the North. I insist very much on that. PHC is not only a valid mindset and strategy for less resourced countries in the South, but also for the wealthy North. It's also something very relevant for my own country, Belgium. But of course, since 1978, the world has dramatically changed. The breadth of health vulnerabilities has expanded. Just to name a few, there's climate change. There are the epidemiological and demographic changes. There are the increasing wealth inequalities and political exclusion. There are the booming health markets with all too often poorly regulated private healthcare sectors leading to commercialization and jeopardized quality of care. But on the positive side, it's not all gloomy. There are the expanding possibilities for patient choice, increased attention for accountability, digital revolution, all opportunities. Now, the Astana Declaration 2018, and I had the privilege and the opportunity to be there in Astana, strongly reiterated the relevance of PHC. But also, the assembly there present also acknowledged that still lots of work remains to be done. We did not fully succeed in implementing primary healthcare. At best, it was said, the glass is only half full. Now, PHC is not only something that is being promoted and advocated by progressive left-wing academics and institutions. Also, the more business-oriented paper, The Economist, recently on a number of occasions made a strong case for primary healthcare systems, as you see in these two quotes. Primary healthcare is not flashy, but it works. It is the central nervous system of a country's medical services. The importance of primary healthcare. It's an essential precondition for a decent healthcare system, and I like the word decent. It's about decency, about rights. Following Astana, a number of politicians, policymakers, practitioners, academics, activists have taken a clear stand on the vital linkage between primary healthcare and universal health coverage. And I do agree, and that is to a large extent the source of inspiration, the rationale for me talking about primary healthcare at a conference on universal health coverage. What is health about? I would like to address the question, that question, and because as I said in my introduction, I think it's difficult to talk about PHC and UHC for that matter without talking about what we actually mean and understand with health. And there's of course there's no standard answer to this. What I want to briefly illustrate in the next couple of slides is that our understanding, our definition of health has somehow evolved over time. And this cannot be without consequences on how we fund, how we design, how we operate, how we evaluate primary healthcare systems. You're all familiar with the, and Professor Joshua has also referred to it yesterday, the 1947 Constitution of the World Health Organization, which says that health is a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease and infirmity. Clearly, on the positive side of this definition is the fact that it goes beyond a purely biomedical perspective and that it encompasses the psychosocial dimensions. On the other hand, it hardly leaves anybody healthy. Who amongst all of us here would then still be healthy if we strictly use that definition? Then there was the Declaration of Alma-Ata, 78. Alma-Ata reaffirmed that definition, but also added that health is a means to an end. It is a status, the end is a status that permits, that enables people to lead a socially and economically productive life as they value it. And this is coherent, I think, with this idea, this concept of capabilities, initially introduced by Amartya Sen and later also picked up by the American philosopher Martha Nussbaum. Capabilities as people's freedoms to do and to be what they have reason to value. And in Nussbaum's list of 10 essential capabilities, one is on being able to have good health. More recently in the Netherlands, the Dutch academic Machteld Huber rethought the definition of health. And this marks, her definition marks a significant departure from the WHO 1947 definition of health. She states, and I quote her, that health is to be seen as the ability to adapt and self-manage in the light of the physical, emotional, and social challenges of life. In the light, just to give a few examples, of the global rise in chronic conditions, in the light of increasing life expectancy, this definition makes a lot of sense. Indeed, this life cycle perspective on health, again, definitely entails concrete implications on how we organize healthcare. The Belgian Christian Mutualities, a social health insurer in my country with about 6 million members, and we are only 11 million people in Belgium, so more than half are members of these Christian Mutualities. They are a major player in the Belgian health system. They are a major purchaser of care. Well, they were inspired by Machteld Huber, and they recently embraced the concept of positive health and developed a spider diagram representing 6 pillars from health. It's about bodily functions, mental well-being, meaningfulness, quality of life, social and societal participation, daily functioning. Health is no longer considered as a static condition, but rather as the dynamic ability in space and time to adapt and to manage one's own well-being. Positive health covers domains like social participation, quality of life, and daily functioning. This was adapted about a year ago by the Christian Mutualities. This is also something that is meant to be used, to be filled in by patients themselves to some extent when visiting their general practitioner or whatever, and try to rate themselves their health situation. How does this translate concretely in the policies of the Christian mutualities, for instance, funding sports clubs for people who are not allowed, who are not in a position to pay it for themselves, rather than treating the effects of lack of sports, promote young people to participate in sports clubs. Organize and facilitate patient groups, diabetes patients, for instance. Having them discuss together, share their experience, and actually provide a little bit of facilitation, a little bit of funding for that, rather than only reimbursing the cost of using a diabetes specialist, etc. Good. Then I come to a second issue I wanted to address in my talk here, is how to operationalize PHC. What are the models of implementation of primary healthcare? And already in this slide is a little bit the summary of what I want to say. It's not about or, it's about and. Let me start with a small anecdote. Last year in September, at the Health Systems Global Conference in Liverpool, the COICA representative, and COICA stands for Korean International Cooperation Agency, said that when his organization started working in Africa, and he referred to Ghana because this is the country where COICA intervened, he said, we did not have a role model to follow. We did not have a clue. We did not have some sort of blueprint for PHC. We are very much in favor of PHC, but what should we do? And he raised, I think, a pertinent issue. How exactly to implement PHC? What is the model to follow? And for COICA, but probably for many other international and domestic financiers, the PHC scene is not always clear. I can imagine, for instance, that for ministers of health finance, of ministers of finance, it's not always very clear. They don't always get a very clear message. The philosophy of PHC may be very clear, its concrete implementation less so. So the point I want to make is that there are multiple and different service models to operationalize primary healthcare. And these different approaches are not necessarily mutually exclusive. They often coexist in different blends, and they can and should complement each other. Take, for instance, the emerging concept of community health systems, where colleagues from South Africa have put this highly on the agenda for a number of years now. It's about addressing the widespread problematic situation of community health workers operating at the fringes of the health system, poorly defined, poorly supported, and all too often instrumentalized by specific single-purposed vertical programs, and therefore unable to completely fulfill their potential. And this is an increasing call to institutionalize community health and to consider it as a unique subsystem in the overall health system. Among some of the most well-known examples are the CHIPS in Ghana, Community Health and Planning Services, the health extension workers in Ethiopia, the ASHAs, accredited social health activists in India, etc. These are more professionalized teams. They are professionalized teams, remunerated, aiming to be embedded in the community, but also integrated in local district health systems. That's one model. Another is the well-known model of the integrated district health system, which you are very familiar with in this country. With small, versatile healthcare teams in health facilities, first-line health facilities, staffed in most low-income countries by non-physician clinicians, by nurse practitioners, by clinical officers. Still the backbone of many African health systems, with outreach activities in the community and supported by a referral hospital as a backup institution. Halfdan Mahler, the late Dr. Halfdan Mahler, who was the visionary director general of the WHO in 1978, was quite explicit, and he said, first referral hospitals at district level have a place, are part of PHC. It is of course far from obvious to coordinate the operation of the variety of health services and health providers in the context of what is called mixed health systems, which is again also a reality in this country. What are health mixed health systems? Health centrally planned government health services that operate side by side with private markets for similarly complementary products and services. Diversity in provision. Dominant but poorly organized private markets, compromised public services, and blurred public-private distinctions. In that context, it's not easy to organize these systems. And the need for strong stewards at district level speaks for itself, supported by a coherent regulatory framework. The training of district stewards was one of the central objectives of the fellowship program Health Systems Management, which was developed a few years ago by Makerere School of Public Health together with ITM, and perhaps this could be picked up again in the future. There is, in addition, there's another model. There is the slowly emerging reality of family doctors, which is increasingly coming up in low and middle income countries. Family doctors operating at the first line, a model that is very much inspired by the European and North American family medicine model. And we see it in Africa. We see it in the Republic of South Africa. We see it in Northern Africa and the Maghreb. We see it in Western Africa. We see it in Mali, in Benin, in Guinea. It's still marginal, but it is increasing. A promising model, even if still in the search of an optimal integration into local health systems, into district health systems. WONCA, that is the World Organization of Family Doctors, is indeed increasingly active in low and middle income countries. And there is, for instance, the Prima FAMED network led by the Ghent University, gathering a variety of players wishing to promote family medicine in a perspective of primary healthcare. It's one of the ways to operationalize primary healthcare. Both Mbarara and Makerere University are part of that network. Next to these formats, there should be a place for specialized health services run by specific disease control programs. There are many of them, as this scheme illustrates very clearly. And the quality of their interaction with existing health systems is highly variable. Sometimes problematic and clearly disruptive, but at the same time also a powerful resource in terms of skills, competences, and resources. And in my experience, there is a place for all these actors and service models in well-thought primary healthcare policies. But they need, of course, to be coordinated and articulated in a systems perspective. In that sense, I would tend to distance myself a little bit from a too narrow view whereby PHC would limit itself to the only first-level contact of people with a health facility. Let me quote some work by Professor Tricia Greenhalgh from the UK, the Grand Dame, the Grand Lady of primary healthcare in that country, and she argues similarly. She writes, and I quote her, that instead of chasing a tight definition of primary healthcare and enforcing it across all countries and healthcare systems, you would be better off with flexible parameters that can be applied with judgment in different contexts. And Greenhalgh proposes a number of features of what she calls contemporary primary care, the new primary healthcare. She mentions multi-professional teams, multidisciplinary teams, proactive as well as reactive care, going out in the community, not only waiting for people to come, populational as well as individual care. Take into account the social and cultural context of illness, the centrality of the patient in his or her own care, an advocacy role for health services, multiple service models and multiple interfaces. She further argues, and that is particularly important, that we need to shift our focus from structure and process of primary care to its core values, and I mention a few. A holistic view, a patient-centered clinical method, equitable care. So conclusion could be that values should be our compass, but that the concrete enacting of primary health care is necessarily contextual and may thus take and will thus take a different shape in a different environment. So let's avoid the copy and paste. Going back to biology, a useful way I find to illustrate this is by referring to the notions of genotype and phenotype. Genotype is about the genetic structure, for instance, of a flower. Have a red flower or a yellow flower. A same genotype, but given the difference in context, a different expression. Well, we know what the genotype of primary healthcare is. The genotype is about values. It is about a broad, respectful, and culture-specific acknowledgement of what health means to people and to communities. It is about accessible, quality healthcare, where patients and communities can participate in decision-making, but also about the recognition that healthcare alone will not do. And the concrete expression of this genotype, the phenotype, will thus vary in function of social-cultural context, resources available, epidemiological profile. Having said this, I believe that a country like Belgium could very well learn from health systems in the South, in line with what I find this a very beautiful concept of reverse innovation. The South innovates and the North captures that. And I think, for instance, if I look at my country, I think about the notion of community health systems, which would deserve a place. And I also think about the implementation of district health systems, which are hardly existing in my country. And I will come back to that later in a couple of minutes. Let me now turn to the relationship between PHC and UHC. PHC, primary health care, and universal health coverage. A same struggle, question mark? My answer is yes, but with a but. And let me start with a boutade coming from my colleague, Dr. Yong Yut from Thailand. He's well known at ITM, he's a former master's student, he did his PhD in Belgium. He's currently working on family medicine in Thailand, and he has been one of the players in the spectacular development of UHC in Thailand over the last number of years. Well, he recently told me, half joking, half seriously, that in Thailand, in reality, we do not yet have UHC. He argued that even if all his people have adequate social and financial protection, the Thai health system is still very much hospital and technology centered, with excessive medicalization of health problems, leading to the undermining of people's autonomy and self-reliance. Well, look, let's look at the famous UHC cube. For sure, a very useful tool, and I'm sure all of you are familiar with it, but there are at least two important limitations to it when we look at it from a primary healthcare perspective. And the first one is that the scheme is only about health services, thus not integrating the necessity to relate and coordinate with other sectors and to address the social determinants in health. And the framework proposed by WHO in 2014, this scheme, nicely visualizes the need for collaboration between health and other actors, and other sectors rather, if people-centered and integrated systems are to be developed. At the intersection, you have the person, universal, equitable, people-centered and integrated health service, the person, the family, the community, but then you have the health health service delivery sector, the health sector, but then the yellow part, all the other sectors. And it's at the intersection of all these that is situated people-centered and integrated health systems. A second limitation of the cube is that it does not explicitly address the issue of quality of care, which precisely is the point that Yong Yut wanted to make. He said it's not because people are not impoverished because they use healthcare, that therefore this is good and rational and PHC-oriented, inspired healthcare. In the recent Lancet series on high-quality health systems, Margaret Crook and colleagues wrote, and again I quote them, "Without deliberate, comprehensive efforts to improve the quality of care globally, UHC will largely be an empty vessel. Expansion of UHC remains essential, but without quality, it will be an abstract and meaningless myth. Here, the contribution of PHC is essential. Quality of care is, of course, about effective clinical care, but it's also about a holistic approach. It's about patient-centered and equitable care, where patients are an active actor who participate in the decision-making process on their health. Not obvious. Later today, my ITM colleague, Evelyn Waweru, will present the extensive work she has done together with Professor Sengoba and myself here in Uganda on the study of the difficult and slow implementation of PCC, of patient-centered care, in the context of Uganda. But there definitely is hope. The SDGs are a powerful opportunity, much more than the Millennium Development Goals that were very much disease-oriented, health problem-oriented. The SDGs are much more comprehensive. And as highlighted some time ago by Professor Peter Hill from Australia in a Lancet editorial, with a question as title, and the answer to the question to the question in the title of the editorial is no. The point he wants to make, the question is no, there are not competing discourses. He writes and he argues that precisely the comprehensive scope of the Sustainable Development Goals locates universal health coverage, one of the targets, in the multisectoral vision of PHC. Another reassuring element is the explicit reference to quality of care of medicines in target 3.8 related to universal health coverage. Now, a few words on the famous multisectoral collaboration, something that comes back over and over in policy documents for years, but that appears so difficult to put in practice. And for sure, there are many reasons for this state of affairs. I would hypothesize that one of them is perhaps the lack of understanding of the relevance of multisectoral collaboration by the medical establishment, who is all too often trained and socialized in a setting where the solutions to people's health problems are medical. For every ill, a pill. Halfdan Mahler, I referred to him, the Director General of WHO in 1978, provocatively said that doctors are perhaps an obstacle to PHC. At the risk of publicly embarrassing Dr. Aloysius Senyonjo from Makerere, Aloysius is a very humble man, I want to say a word on his PhD research on which he just embarked. The research is precisely about multisectoral collaboration and may eventually prove to be extremely useful for the further development of PHC in the Ugandan health system. So I wish him lots of success, and I hope that these findings may translate into policies. I know I'm a bit running out of time, but allow me to end with two slides referring to my own health system in Belgium. I had the opportunity at some point in time, about a year or 10 ago, to be involved in the management of the social welfare system, the social services in my own home municipality during 8 years. a huge learning experiences in the midst of the health, of the social sector. Well, in my experience, it is worth what it is worth, it's very context bound. The dynamics for multisexual collaboration mainly came from the social welfare sector, responsible for the care of elderly, for the management of poverty, for the management of social exclusion, with all the health and well-being consequences to which they led, but not per se from the healthcare providers in that same municipality. With a key role for social workers. Social workers as boundary spanners, I like that concept of boundary spanners, it's about people and it requires quite some skills, that precisely want to bridge silos, overcome silos. Another element, another recent development in my country, at least in the Flemish region, because health is a regional matter, is the recent creation of first line zones. If we use our language, we talk about districts. It's in 2018 that Flanders and Belgium discovered districts, population, well-defined population with a team heading the health services, trying to coordinate things, etc. So there is a whole reform being implemented to develop these first line zones. I don't want to get into details. What I find so very interesting is that the governance structures that is supposed to head these first line councils, these first line zones, the governance structure are called care councils, not healthcare councils, care councils. And when you look at the composition, again, it is worth what is worth, there are perhaps too many people, you have representatives from the local government authorities, locally, democratically elected institutions. You have representatives from the healthcare delivery sector, nurses, family doctors, physiotherapists, pharmacists, but you have also a representative from the social welfare sector, also a place for individual citizens and optional members. I find this very interesting. Perhaps this is an idea to be tested in Uganda in an action research perspective, not talk about or not have district health management teams, rather not having district healthcare management teams, but district health management teams and giving a broad, or district care management teams, giving a broader definition and involving other actors than only the healthcare providers in the team. This is my final slide, and with ladies and gentlemen, with all due humility, because I've not been recently to the field in Uganda, but from as a very interested observer from a distance, let me share with you what I would see as some ways forward in implementing PHC in your country, in your health system, and advancing in the direction of UHC, that is, at community level, strong village health teams. A bit going in the direction of community health systems that the people from South Africa, Helen Schneider, and others have been trying to put on the agenda. A key role for health centers 2 and health centers 3. These are the places, if a system functions, where the majority of the people go and where the majority of their problems should find a solution and could find a solution. I think there's a key place, but it's a bit a cliche, an open door, a key place for local governments. As motor, of course, they need capacity, they need training, but as mentor, as motor in implementing intersexual collaboration, health in all policies and addressing social determinants in that. By definition, intrinsically, local governments have to consider a number of sectors. They're not focusing on one sector. And of course, on the enabling national policy framework, including adapted human resources for health training policies and curricula. Okay. Let me end here. And thank you very much for your attention.